Welcome to breadboarding. In video 17, I've actually broken it down into three parts because it was just getting a little bit too long to fit into one video. In the first part, I'm going to be looking at improving breadboard power. As soon as you start to add more than about three or four breadboards together, then the power distribution becomes really important for building reliable projects. So this first video is going to look at that. Then part two is going to look at replacing the address decoder with a programmable logic device. And then in the third part, we'll then look at using that programmable logic device to change the memory map so that the Nanocomp can use all 64K of memory, and we'll be increasing the amount of RAM available to the computer from 4K up to 32K. But first of all, in part one, what we're going to look at is how I've developed improved power distribution techniques over the last 2 years or so, as I found some difficult to trace down problems have actually been caused by low voltage to certain areas of the circuit. So to start with, we're going to be looking at building a small breadboard power connector, and that's based on Veraboard, and then soldering in some 0.1 inch connectors, and also looking at a hack modular breadboard Budy power rail, which I've got a number of these from Hack Modular on Indy, fitting these to replace the red and black power leads at the end of each breadboard. So first we're going to look at cutting up small bits of stripboard or Veraboard to make these connectors. Using a saw is not very easy, so here's a technique I've learnt from other sites on the internet. It makes a much cleaner job of cutting up small bits of stripboard than using a saw. What we've got here is a bit of stripboard, and what we're going to be doing is to cut this down into an 8-hole length, and then we want to further divide this up into 2-hole wide strips, and we're going to use this to make a power connector. Now, to cut stripboard or Veraboard is always been quite a challenge, but I did see a tip on another site, which I don't have to hand at the moment, it seems to show a much easier way of doing this. And what we need to do is, with a nice hard steel rule and craft knife like this, what you actually do is score down the place where we want to make the break. We score down that a number of times. A few times, and there's a bit of a score mark there. What we then do is to use a pair of pliers to then twist the board and see if we can break it. It should snap quite cleanly. There we go. That's generally a lot cleaner than you would get with, if you're trying to do this using a saw or something like that. You could also score the end of the side if you wanted to. And then I just want to break these down to smaller strips. So I'm just going to score the side here. Difficult to that. We might just turn these over and just do a cautionary strip on the other side as well. Let's give it two holes and then we'll do that side. So we'll just give that a whirl. It should hopefully snap a bit more easily. And then finally, we just need to snap our, you see it? There we go. And so what we've got is a fairly neat two-hole strip. We're actually going to be using it from this side. And then what we need to do is to file it using a file like this, and so I'll file that down. smooth it. Okay, so what I'm going to show you now is these Hack Modular Breadboard Budy. This is a little thing that you can get from the hackaday.com Tindy store. I'll leave the URL in the description below. And what these allow you to do is, rather than having the wires at the end of each board, what you can do is to solder a couple of pins in. So if you see here, I've got two pins either side, which I've just basically pulled out of a 10th of an inch edge connector type thing there. And all we're going to do, these are double-sided, through plated, and they're multi-layer PCB, so there's actually tracks going between there. So it's a slightly neater way of plugging the power rails and your breadboards in. The only issue with these things are that they do cover up two of the holes at the end there. So you can see that we lose two of the holes at the end. Now, in most designs, that's not really an issue, but if you really needed the extra space, then you could obviously just wire in the power rails in this way, which I've done up till now. But I think this is a little bit neater and probably will give a slightly better electrical connection. These pins are really quite long, and they're all the way down into the base of the breadboard, whereas these things can be a little bit loose. And also, these particular pins, I have two lots of pins that I use. The higher quality circular pins are probably better for the general components, but you can see here that this one has got circular pins, whereas this one is sort of square. What I've found is that the square ones probably fit the breadboard power better, so you get a better connection. So what we're going to do here is just to solder in the an old breadboard that I use just for this type of thing. And all we're going to do is to heat pins, and hopefully the solder will go through. Okay, so that's those soldered. We'll just see whether or not these have gone through to the other side through hole plating here. The solder has come down a little. The benefit of these is that you see they've got quite long pins here. There we go. Make good power connections from the power supply onto the breadboards, that it really would make sense to use these little strips that I made earlier. I cut the strip board out. So these have got two holes wide, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 along. And what I'm going to do here is do this so that we can plug in the three connectors for each power rail. I found that with two pins, it just got a little bit, just a little loose, and they sometimes came out. And what we want this to do is to come over here, and what we're going to do is to actually plug power wires to come in from the bottom there. Now, in order for this to work nicely, what we're going to do is, rather than soldering it in that way, what I have is a little two hole in here, and we're just going to put that in there. What that means is that when we're soldering this, it would mean that all the pins are actually in level, so we don't end up with any angle on them. So we're just going to solder this, and then we'll add some wires onto the end. What we're going to do is to use this like this, and we're just going to play. Okay, that's a bit
better using length of soldering on.
Okay, and obviously we don't want to solder those because this is just a little jig for us to hold these in. So what we now have is a very robust connector for plugging in the end here, and it also happens to just go over the. So now what we can do is we can get cable coming in underneath here What we've been using up to now for power is an old Apple iPod 1 amp power supply. So this is a fairly old one. And I think in my breadboarding hints and tips, I showed what was happen with the various power supplies when you start to increase the current. Generally up to about 1 amp, they should be okay for providing 5 volts. But depending on the power supply, once you go over about 1 amp, the voltage tends to drop off. And all we're using here, this was just a standard USB cable with a type A connector on one end and the other standard connector on the other. And all I've done is chopped off the cable and I put 4 breadboard connector wires with the sort of pluggable contacts in there. I have left the other 2 leads on there. USB power supplies can detect what type of device is plugged into and will regulate the amount of power they send out through the pins, depending on the values, the voltages on these 2 cables. I thought originally I might have needed to put some of those voltages on the 2 data cables to get more power out of these, but you can get up to 1 amp out of it, so it's not really a problem. But perhaps I'll do a video on these and in future to look at how you can get 2 amps or even more than that out of the USB power supply by adjusting the voltages on the 2 data cables. But what we're going to do now is to look at how I've replaced this sort of single USB power supply. And certainly as you start to build more complicated projects and get beyond about 3 or 4 breadboards, if you want to have reliable projects, you really do need to look at improving the power. So the first thing really that you really need to consider doing, if you're serious about this, is getting some form of benchtop power supply. Now the one I've got is from Amazon, a Hamantech HM310. I think it was about £50 or £60. And this is capable of doing up to 30 volts and up to about 9.9 amps, I think. From some of the reviews I've seen of this, the only real comment that most people have made, and which I would agree with, is that the adjustments on here, we just click it and press the button to go on to each one. The only issue is if you're a little bit late, it goes back to finishes. So you can sort of see here, you have to be quite quick to move the values. But other than that, it's not really a big issue. And once you're used to it, it's not really a problem. Tend to leave it stuck on 5 volts. I'll leave it at 1 amp for the moment, just because you don't really want to have it set higher than that in case you accidentally connect short the contacts. But in general, you can see what the current usage is, and it's quite useful. Certainly when you can sort of see when you're getting to the upper limits of your current power settings. So when you just plug that, switch that on, you can see at the moment it's drawing 0 amps at the moment. Desktop bench power supply, whatever type you get, doesn't really matter too much. The main thing is you want to keep it stuck on 5 volts and you'll adjust the current as you increase the number of components in your circuit. The only thing I did notice on this one is that both these connectors were black. The main connector, that screw connector, were black, although there was a red terminal around that. I have put some red tape around it, so I'm less likely to make mistakes with it. What I generally do with this is I have some 4mm banana plug leads that I just plug into there. Now, I made my own leads, and I'll show you how I did that. Right, so when I first got my desktop bench power supply, I did buy a pack of wires like this. Again, this was from Amazon. They are silicon coated wires with a standard banana plug on one end and with sort of a breadboard style connector on the end. I think there were 2 black, 2 red, and then the other colors there. And that's fine. The only issue is that they're not very long. And so really, after a little while, it became apparent I needed to come up with a better solution for that. And I was looking at the various 4mm banana plug connectors and things, and in the end, it seemed to be better to actually buy this pack of sockets and plugs for not very much, a couple of pounds, I think it was, and also was able to buy lengths of the silicon wire with, again, quite thick cores. And I made these cables up for, you know, not very much each. I also then had a black plastic sort of box here, and all I've done is used these sockets and wired them together internally So I kind of made myself a power distribution, because what I was finding is I needed a long cable to go from the bench power supply in there, and then it means that I can use these shorter cables to plug into the breadboard. What I've also now done as well, what I did find over a period of time, that just plugging these in from this distribution point wasn't quite enough. And what I ended up looking for is some power distribution blocks. Now these 12 watt ones designed, I think, for boats and caravans and things like that. And what I did is so these are the full size ones, and you also can buy, these sort of bus bars as well at the same time. Now, having one of these dedicated to each power rail is a bit much. So what I've done is I cut them in half, put some tape over them, and made one half one voltage and one half the other. So the nature of these strips are that each side is connected, but you need these bus bars to connect the individual things together. And then what I've done is mounted 2 4-millimeter sockets into just a bit of an aluminium extrusion, and I've got some thick copper cable that I took out of some fixed copper wiring for mains wiring, and it's been insulated. And what I was trying to do here is to really, it's probably way over the top, but because I had such trouble with power distribution on one of my earlier bigger projects, I thought I would kind of overdo it, as it were, so that I didn't have any power problems. So this will mean that you should be at very close to 5 volts all throughout your circuit. As I said in some of my earlier videos, I was getting up to down to about 3.6 volts at some point of the circuit, and obviously a lot of the chips just won't work properly at 3.6 volts. That's the other reason why I have a little mini power meter on the breadboards, just so you can see if you've got that type of problem. So what I'm going to do here then is to use this strip here. And as I've already shown earlier in the video, we have made these power distribution. So this is a power distribution board, as it were. So what you're trying to do here is to get a really strong connection. So with 3 square pins rather than round pins, and those plug in, and then the wires are going to be soldered up into the bottom there. Those will produce really sturdy connections which won't wobble around and cause problems with the power. One of the other things I did notice as well, when measuring resistance across these, we'll plug all this in and see what the total resistance end to end is, allowing your own meter to settle for a while, because on the very low resistances, my meter can take up to about 20-30 seconds for it to really fully settle down to the real resistance. So you might get a reading of 0.4 or 0.5 ohms, and then over about 20-30 seconds, it'll settle down to 0.1 or 0.2 ohms. So just give your meter a little bit of time when you're measuring this. So I'm just going to do now is to hook this in. We're going to have a look at what the total resistance end to end is. Okay, so I just soldered in 2 standard bits of hookup wire. As I said, I have tried to use thicker wire, but the problem you run into, you use thicker than the hookup wire, gets so thick that when you plug these connectors into the breadboards, that the wire actually causes the connectors to lift out. So this was generally found to be better. And then what I'll then do is to hook up the ends here to the terminal block here. So what I'm going to do is to undo this one here and this one here. Needs to be made a loop. And then we will just, I seem a little bit over the top to do this, but it will be worth it in the long run. And then just create that one there. Again, it's possible to have multiple wires going into the same terminal, but generally I haven't needed more than 4. These on a given project at the moment. Okay, so now we have those. So we have our junction box going off to the power supply. We have our terminal block And then this wire is fairly easy to route around the outside of the breadboard. This is then plugged in here. I'm going to measure the resistance using this meter. I'm just going to hook the meter actually up to the ends that go into the bench power supply. This is going to give me a reading of what the total end-to-end resistance on the power supply down to the breadboard is. And all I'll do here, in fact, is I will just use this link at the end of the breadboard here. So as I said, if we just let that settle, we'll find that it will, and when we first plug it in, so if I just unplug that and we plug it in first time, and it starts about 0.5, we'll drop down to about 0.4. So it's about 0.4 of an ohm. If we're drawing 1 amp, that would result in to 0.4 of a volt potentially being lost across the circuit. And let me just show you one of the connectors that I was using previously that was causing me a problem. These leads here I was using when I was doing the buffer project. And if we just put those together on there, that's 1.5, 1.2 ohms. And if I move it around, you can see the resistance is changing quite substantially. So these, I'm just going to throw these away. You can see here that there must be loose connections in here because they really are not very good at all. So again, be careful with what type of leads you're using, because obviously some of them are wetter than others. This is almost 2 ohms, one to two ohms. And when using this, I was only getting about 3.6 volts on some parts of the circuit. So this is the precautionary tale. So 0.4 ohms end to end from one end all the way through the whole circuit. So in actual fact, going through one end of the circuit will only be about 0.2 of an ohm. Okay, so what I've done now is I've replaced all of the wire links that we had with these hack modular power rail connectors. The only slight issue is that you can't have two side by side like this. So you do have to put one at the end of the board if you're going to have two together like that. But that's not really a big issue. And we'll see when we switch on and see what the power is going to be. So what I have done at the top here is I've wired in another one of these little connectors. So I've basically got one carrying the CPU and the buffer board, and then I have another one here up here feeding the peripheral interface adapters and also the LED display there. The connections we've got over here should be sufficient to drive this area. Probably in later videos, what we might end up doing is actually strapping some of the power rails up across here as well. So we've added all of the extra power supply in there. We've got all of our 4mm plug sockets plugged in. And then if we just have a look at the power supply, if I just switch that on, and you'll see there that's now reading about 0.49 amps. You can see the Nanocomp monitor is running. It's 1000. And you can also see down here that our power supply here is about 4.96 volts. Now that's higher than we've been getting. I mean, sometimes it's gone down to about 4.7 volts with the USB power supply. And if you just plug this around on some of the other power rails, yeah, 4.96 there. We plug all the way in over here. Here we go, and we got some 4.96 volts there as well. So you can obviously use a multimeter to do this, but I just find these little meters really handy. I tend to put them on the far extreme areas of the board or new boards that I'm building. So that's improving breadboarding power. If you follow this advice, then hopefully you won't have any power distribution problems on breadboard projects, and they should be a lot more reliable, and you'll avoid wasting time. In the next video, we're going to be looking at part two, where we're replacing the address decoder with a programmable logic device and programming that device and configuring it. If you don't want to miss out on that video, please hit subscribe. And if you found it interesting, please also hit like. Thanks for watching.